Good morning, respected teachers and dear colleagues. In today's faculty lecture series, we are discussing the principle of PET-CT. Before the starting of the PET-CT, we have to describe what is the nuclear medicine, in which we are using the very small amount of the sealed radioisotopes for functional imaging as well as for therapeutic purpose. So why we required this branch? Because nuclear medicine imaging help in early detections or early discovery of changes in the patient body functions. So what is the difference between the nuclear medicine and the radio diagnosis? In the radio diagnosis, this is a transmission images where we are putting the radiation sources at one side of the body and we are taking the images from the other side of the body. So these are the transmission images from where we are taking the anatomical images. In the nuclear medicine part, we are injecting the radioisotopes inside the body. We are taking the images of the radioactive substance from the inside the body. And patient body is emitting the radio nuclide, gamma rays or photons. And these photons are captured by the detectors and we are taking out the images. These are the emission images and these are the functional images. So about the evolution of the nuclear medicine images, we started from the 2D images and now at time we are doing the 3D whole body fusion images. The entire department is divided in the PET, gamma camera, nuclear cardiology and radionuclide therapy clinic. In the nuclear medicine, today we have to discuss about the PET-CT part. In our department, we have one SPECT system and one PET-CT system at here. What is the workflow of the nuclear medicine? We are generating the radionuclide by different sources. We are generating from the cyclotron and like a 99M technician, we are generating from the generators. And other part of the radio pharmaceutical is the pharmaceutical from where we are targeting the radio pharmaceuticals for the different type of the body functions. After the generating of radionuclide and preparing of the pharmaceutical, we are going to bind up these two things and preparing the radio pharmaceuticals. We are injecting these radio pharmaceutical products after the specific time period. So about the spectrum of the disease covered in the nuclear medicine or PET-CT is the not only the malignant diseases, we are also covering the benign diseases or benign functional evaluation of the different organs. So we have to start with PET-CT. Before the starting of the PET-CT, we generally understand about the PET-CT system. In this PET-CT system, this is the console where the nuclear medicine technologist is sitting and acquiring the images. And patient is lying down inside the PET-CT acquisition room on the table or couch. And this and this is the gantry. Why we are showing this? In the gantry part, there is two rows of the detectors, one row for the CT system and one row for the PET. And in this part, we have a control panel for moving the table and couch inside and outside and up and down. We have a setup of ledgers for the RT planning and for the biopsy or FNAC purpose. And we have a bore. Bore is the diameter of the gantry. And on the basis of this bore system, we are dividing these PET-CT system in two parts, wide bore and the medium bore system. Small bore system already outdated. And we have a medium bore system at our side.
The cursor, Professor,
I think In the detector systems, we have a CT detector at the beginning of the gantry and the PAT detector at the exit of the gantry. And these two detector rolls are fitted in the same gantry system. And this is an open system. Actually, this is the open from the outside and inside. The length of the gantry is varied from for the detector rolls. More detector rolls, the diamond width of the gantry is increased. So it's a sound proof, and there is no sound during the acquisition. This is an open system, and nowadays we have a medium bore system. The large bore system is required at outside of the country because their patients are heavier than Asian country people. So in the USA, they have a bite bore system. The bore size and diameter of the gantry bore is centimeter at that side. At our site, we have a 98 centimeter of the bore. About the principle, and what is the principle of this PAT system? We are selecting the radionuclide which have a property of the decay of the positron emission. What is the positron? Positron is the positively charged electron, just like a electron, but have a positively charged mass, energy, and charge value is relative, equally same to the electron, but charge is different from the electron. So we are injecting this radionuclide inside the body, and it is emitting the positively charged positron from the after the decay. And this positively charged electron is collide with the targeted, and after the collision with the targeted electron, both are annihilate and emit the two annihilation photons. The energy of two annihilation photons is equal, and these are directed to each opposite to each other. And the energy of both photons is 511 keV. And these photons, these are going in opposite direction, is detected by the detectors. These are situated opposite to each other window, and this time window is defined for every PET CT system. It's called a true coincidence. It's a true event for the every PET system.
One question over. What do you mean by true coincidence is when both detectors are detecting positron
annihilation photons
at the same time?
Same time.
Then it is considered to be positive.
Yes. Okay. If it is not detected in this time coincidence window or time resolution window, this event is not called as it.
Does it mean that only your events which are true coincidence are registered as positivity?
Yes.
Which are these radionuclides that emit positrons?
Yes, sir. I will.
Come to that?
Yes. So, these are the list of the radionuclides which are emitting these positively charged electrons or positrons. These are the 68 gallium, F18, copper 64, zirconium, ID. These are the various radionuclides which are emitting the positively charged electron or positron, and out of these we are commonly using the F18 and gallium 68 because these have a favorable half life, favorable energy, and favorable range in the body. So commonly we are using the F18 labeled radionuclides. Commonly at our site we are using the F18 labeled FDG. F18 is the
जो स्टूडेंट्स देख रहे हैं उनका स्लाइड मूव नहीं हो
रहा
है, डिस्प्ले चेंज करना है। पहले क्या डुप्लीकेट किया था
स्क्रीन
चल रहा है, ये चल रहा है ना, ये करो। यस गड़बड़ हुआ,
हाँ चेंज हो गया। ठीक है, यस यस
Most of the radio nuclide are generated by the generator and the cyclotrons on the basis of the property of the radio nuclide. Like in this list, we are generating F-18 from the cyclotron by PN reaction from O-18 in water. The gallium-68 is generated by the germanium gallium generator. It is an in-house generator. So, other mode of the production of the radionuclide is the reactor also. So, in reactor, most of time we are producing the radionuclide for the therapeutic purpose. So, about the F-18-FDG. F-18 is the radionuclide. FDG is the pharmaceutical. Combining with both of them is radiopharmaceutical. What is that? We have already discussed about the F-18. About what is the FDG? FDG is a glucose particle. In this glucose particle, we are replacing the hydroxyl molecule at the carbon second with the F-18. After the replacing this hydroxyl molecules, it is not a part of the glycolysis path. And what is this? Actually, like a similar to glucose, F-18-FDG is also entering inside the active transport or by the facilitated diffusion by glute transporter. And after the entering inside the cells, it is also converted by the hexakinase enzyme in 18F-FDG6-phosphate. After conversion of this, it is not a part of the isomerase enzyme, so it cannot be converted into the F-18 fructose phosphate, so it is not a part of the glycolysis. It is not also converted into the lactone, glucolactone, so it is not to be a part of HMP shunting, not to be converted into the glycogen, and it also cannot be reversed. So it has been storage inside the cells. So it is the pharmaceutical, it is attached to the cells, and by the using of F-18, we are detecting the targeted cells. So these are the mechanism of glucose uptake, and there are the various facilitated diffusion sites by using the glute transporters.
It's like sequestered within the cell, not further metabolized. So it, how does it finally be determined? It decays, or how is it excreted eventually, or it just stays in the cell?
It remains inside the cells. After the decaying of the 18F-FDG, it's living long lasting. And after the decaying of F-18, F-18 after decay, it's converted in the O-18. And after O-18, it's converted into O-16. So it's become like a water molecule. And it's remain inside, after decaying, it's like a non-radioactive substance inside the cells.
Just a single query, what is the time limit for that?
Actually, we have two half-lives of the each area of pharmaceuticals. One is the physical half-life and second is the biological half-life. Physical half-life of every radio pharmaceutical is defined. It's for 18F-FDG, it's 110 minutes, around 2 hours. And biological half 30 to 50 minutes, depends on the body metabolism. Some person also defined it's around 25 minutes also, but average half-life is 30 to 50 minutes. So effective half-life is always closer to the shorter half-life. So effective half-life is always near to 30 to 50 minutes. So after the 5 half-lives, we are defining it should remain near negligible radioactivity inside the cells or inside the body.
3 to 4 hours.
That means in this duration, patient is
Patient is generating the radioactivity, but this radioactivity is not quite high in amount, so it can harm to the other people.
You
have told
me that 2.4 mm ka, 18F ka, that is the duration, that is how fast that it is being transmitted?
Yes.
So then how is it picked up by the scanner?
Sir, I want to tell you about the range of this formal. About this, the range of the positron. Of the positron, it travels around 2.4 mm and is annihilated and collide with the electron and annihilate. So this range is the limitation of the specificity. And in this longer the range, there is the decrease in the resolution of the specificity. So we are selecting the radionuclide which have the energy near equivalent to 511 keV.
2.4 millimeter is when the positron is colliding with the electron. 2.4 yes. mm is how far it is traveling.
The positron is travel around 2.5 mm.
And then it probably collides with the emits the photon.
The yes. photon is emitted after 2.4
mm. Yes. So the photon is then detected by the detector.
Yes.
Regarding insulin usage, you will come later.
Yeah, I will. So, about the indications of the PET-CT at our site, we are using for oncology, for carcinoma of unknown primary, for paraneoplastic etiologies, for inflammatory disorders like sarcoid tuberculosis, for fungal infections, for detection of the cause of pyrexian and origin diseases, we have used also yet here, for myocardial inflammation as well as for bivalty. For inflammatory joint prosthesis, we are also doing the PET-CT guided biopsies, RFA, FNAC at here. And we are also commonly doing the PET-CT guided radiotherapy planning. And first time we have done the PET-CT guided RFA for TIO at here.
What is this organ and risk plan?
Sir, actually, just like in TIO, tumor-induced osteomalacia,
yeah.
actually there is a one site where it is producing some factors, like FGF2 factors, which is causing the osteomalactic changes inside the body. So, by the PET-CT, we are detecting this organ at risk, and we are targeting this organ at risk, like like in the meaning, like this thing, if we are going for ablate for TIO lesion and the most common susceptible sites are the bone, so it is detecting the most susceptible sites of the bone. And some patients, it is the most critical site is the most critical organ is kidney, most critical organ is the liver. So PET-CT we are detecting the which organ is getting the highest harm or getting the highest susceptible risk for the dysfunction or for other site, other causes. The contraindication for PET-CT, the only or only contraindication is the pregnancy. For other things, we can do it. Seriously ill patients, we can do for the PET-CT. High serum creatinine value, patient cannot lie down on supine position, and high blood glucose level, relatively contraindication, not a absolute contraindication for us. So why we require these imagings? Because these are the whole body imagings, and in the CT or MR, these are the regional imagings. And on the basis of the PET-CT imaging, we can differentiate its viable and non-viable tissue, and we can pick the early functional changes. So we can also detect the early disease and early response.
You told us the principle, but I mean, why, how, what is the property of FDG or these radiopharmaceuticals that they pinpoint tumor? Or are there other reasons why it is specific for tumor and inflammation?
Sir, actually, FDG is related to glucose metabolism. And the property of the tumor is decided, and property of the radiopharmaceutical part we are targeting for the detection is depend on the pharmaceutical property. Radionuclide is only used for detection. If we are targeting the oncology cells, we have a concept the oncology cells has the higher metabolism as compared, and they are accumulating the, they are consuming more glucose as compared to normal body cells. So we have used the radioactivated glucose for the detection of the these cancer cells. Like in prostate cancer cells, we are targeting the receptors. So at that site, we are targeting the PSMA receptors. So we are using the PSMA labeled F18 or PSMA labeled gallium at that site. So target site is always cell property.
Inflammation is the same thing for tuberculosis, chronic inflammatory conditions, myocardium.
Mm-hmm.
You are again related to the blood flow and the oxygen utilization.
Sir, we are actually flow related tracers are different and metabolism related tracers are different. For flow related tracers, generally we are using the in SPECT system or gamma camera system, we are using the different flow systems. In the PET system, we are using the ammonia. And level ammonia for the flow detection of the organs. Now time we are talking about the body metabolism. It's related to metabolism of the cells. In the inflammations, they are increase the metabolism at that the sites. They are accumulating the more glucose as compared to normal sites. So we are also using these things for the inflammation also. About the instructions to the patient in the FDG PET, there are only the most common instruction is the fasting. We are required the 6-hour fasting prior to the 18F FDG PET CT. And we also telling to the admitted patient, they have not to infuse the intravenous fluid which are containing the dextrose containing saline and dextrose containing substance before the 6 hours of the PET scan. And also avoiding the excessive 12 hours before the study. And you can take regular medications. For diabetic patients, we are giving the special instructions. And for female patients, we are also telling to them if she is pregnant or she likely to pregnant or about the breastfeeding status, they have to inform us. About the insulin, and for the most of times we are denying the patient not to administer the insulin before the study because the insulin mediated glucose uptake occur inside the skeletal muscles, so we cannot see the targeted tissue inside the body. So we are denying to administer the insulin before the study. About the procedure steps, we are to the patients and after.
So what is the method of glucose control? Patient who is having hyperglycemia, say sugar of 300, 400. So when we can take up them from that?
So actually we are at 4 hours. Our side, the actual cutoff limit for the FDG PET CT is for different guidelines different. From the ENM guidelines, they have given the cutoff value of 200 milligram per DL for the FDG PET CT. And they have given the cutoff limit 120 milligram per DL. But we can take the patient up to the 300 milligram per DL blood glucose levels. At our site, what we are doing, we are giving the short-acting insulin to the patients. And by this short-acting insulin, we are regulating the blood glucose. But this procedure we are performing approximate 2 or 3 hours before the study. So the effective half-life of the short-acting insulin is negligible at the time of the administration of radioactivity. So in the procedure steps, we are injecting the radioactive glucose or F18 level FDG inside the body by the IV route, and we are giving the instruction patient remain quiet inside the patient waiting area for at least 1 hour, and he or she can take the plenty of water and go for urination. And after the waiting, pairing the scan. In the scanner, patient remain around 12 to 15 minutes for the scanning. And After the scan acquisition, if we require the extra images, we stop the patient. If we are not requiring the extra images, we are also taking the reading at the abdominal levels before the releasing the patient from the to the external environments. These readings are necessary for the releasing before the releasing the patients. If these readings are 25 microsievert at 1 meter distance, we are releasing the patient to the external environments. And it means it's a permissible limit to release the patient after the diagnostic and therapeutic purpose.
25 microsievert at 1 meter.
Yeah, 1 meter at abdominal level.
What is the dose you normally use of the radionuclide in terms of the radioactivity when you give a patient for a routine PET-CT?
Yes, sir. Actually, we are using the different amount of the radioactivity for the different purpose. If we are using 18F18FDG for the intervention purpose, we are giving the very less amount of the radioactivity, so we have not received the so much amount of the radioactivity, or we have not received so much amount of the radiation from the patient to us during the interventions. For diagnostic purpose, it's a different on the basis of the body weight. If for ideal 70 kg body weight, we are injecting 10 millicurie or 370 megabecquerel to the patient, body weight is increased. And then we are increasing the body radioactivity dose to the patient. But maximum permissible dose is around 14 millicurie for the patient. In gallium level Dotanov PET CT or like 18F level PSMA or gallium level PSMA PET scans, at that time we are injecting the dose to the patient is 2 to 5 millicurie for the diagnostic purpose, because they are more specific. So, what is the conceptual framework of the PET diagnosis? These are the graph. This is detecting the for the diagnosis of the any disease. We require around 10 to our 9 cells for the diagnosis. For symptomatic, the cells should be more than 10 to power 10. And if cell number is increases, the center cells or the necrosis of the cells. For the diagnosis, it required around 100 gram of the cells, or it means 10 to power 10 to 10 to power 11 cells. At our site, the PET system of has a 0.4 centimeter of the resolution. In this resolution window, we are detecting around 1 gram of the cells, and corresponding to the 1 gram of these cells is correspond to 10 to power 8 cells. Negative PET scan at the end of therapy is not mean there is no cancer cells. It may be there is as many as 10 to power 10, 7 cells. So a completely negative PET scan at the end of therapy typically suggests a good prognosis. It doesn't necessarily correspond to absence of the cancer cells. On the contrary, in the absence of the inflammation, positive FDG PET scan after the several cycle of the treatment is usually residual tumors. So most of time it's a question to us how many days of the time gap after the radiotherapy, surgery or chemotherapy for the PET scan. Actually, this time gap is defined by the different guidelines. After the chemotherapy, we are taking the minimum of the 10 days time gap. And after the radiation, we are taking around the 2 to 3 months. And about the surgery, we can take the patient at any time after the surgery. It depends on the information what you want to receive. If you have done the intervention at the primary site and you want to see the everything, you can send the patient on the same day or day after the your interventions. We can give you the entire information. If you want to see the other than the primary site of the inflammation, you can send the patient at any day after your intervention.
They need to wait for the after surgery. We can do
when. Yes, sir. And initially, in the initial beginning days, after the your surgical intervention, the acute inflammation is it takes the 2 to 3 days to establish at that site, primary site. So we can do the early scanning after the procedure. It's not hampered by the acute or active inflammation. So what measurement of this FDG activity? It's mainly measured by the qualitative and quantitative ways. In quantitative, we are using the ICV max, and there are other methods, kinetic modeling and total lesion glycolysis. In SUV, most of time we are mentioning SUV max. And what is the SUV? This is the uptake value at the targeted site divided by the injected dose, but divided by the patient body weight. Sometimes using the lean body mass, and at the time of the using of the lean body mass, we are defining is SUL. About the total lesion glycolysis, total lesion glycolysis is the mean SUV of the total tumor and total tumor volume in ml. Actually, in the current PET-CT systems, it is very tough to define the total tumor volumes. So we are not common in glycolysis. So every tumor doesn't show the high grade FDG ability. It's not a mean every cancer cell is showing the high grade uptake. So there are few of the cancers, they are showing the low grade FDG uptake, like a low grade lung adenocarcinoma, RCC, mucinous neoplasms. In hepatocellular carcinoma, lymphoma and prostate cancers, there is a variable, there is a always low grade FDG uptake. If it is showing the high grade FDG uptake, it's related to poor prognosis and poor response to the treatments. So in the lymphoma, prostate cancer and SCC, hepatocellular carcinoma, it's important to report the degree of FDG uptake. It's high degree or low degree or it's moderate degree of FDG uptake. So now a time it's a DICOM era, so always all are in the images at their DICOM systems. So most of time they have confused with the other things. So what the pitfalls during the image interpretations, how you identify your FDG PET scan, it is showing the high grade FDG uptake in the brain parenchyma. Other than the FDG PET scan, no other PET scan is not showing the brain uptake. The brain is highlighting, so you are seeing the F18 FDG PET scan at your site. It is a normal physiological uptake. And the extraocular muscles is also showing the physiological uptake because most every time they are working, because patient is not remain quiet at the time of the waiting period, is always seeing here and there, so it's also showing the uptake. In the winter season, the brown fat is activated, so the most of time we are facing the very much difficulty during the image interpretation. The brown fat distribution during the cervical abatible area and perineal area, it's showing the FDG ability or showing the uptake of FDG PET scan, but there is no tissue in the CT images.
All of those sites are brown fat, right? Apart from the bladder and the brain and the heart, everything?
No.
Apart from the brain?
No. Actually, the physiological FDG uptake is in the brown, myocardium, excreted by the kidney and the urinary bladder.
Apart from that,
these are the brown fat.
But what is done by the PET scan cannot be used for detecting brain mets.
No, sir. Actually, in the before this era, we are using only PET scan. Now time we are using the PET CCT scans. We are using the contrast in CCT scans at the time of the PET scans. So we are doing the contrast in CCT images for the brain parenchyma. So we are as good as the CCT detection of the brain regions. If we are calling out only isolatedly PET system, we are poor. If we are talking with PET CC system, we are very good.
So what you are doing is then equivalent to doing a CCT. Is PET giving any additional advantage in that place?
Yes. Yes.
Not for brain secondaries, but for other
brains. Brain secondaries, we are very good. We are very good. FDG PET CT is always.
Does FDG add to the CCP?
Yes.
Okay.
No, yes, sir. It is showing the uptake. But when there is any metastatic disease inside the brain parenchyma, it's showing the most of the time it's showing the perilesional edema. So extend to the lesion, in the PET scan, the perilesional edema is not showing any FDG uptake and the lesion is highlighted inside within the brain parenchyma. It is also a static region, it's showing a high uptake as compared to the background.
So when we combine this triple face CT abdomen for this abdomen and along with this PET scan, so when you give this FDG through the IV route, when is the contrast given for taking the triple face imaging? It is consistent or after sequential?
About the thymic activity in children, most of time it is V shape, and about the myocardium, it is showing the physiological FDG uptake. Whenever we are detecting the myocardial malformations or myocardial viability, we are preparing the patient in different way. It is a preparation of patient for myocardial inflammation is totally different in the normal PET scans. After the insulin administrations or after the taking of the meal, if we are acquiring the PET scan, it looks like this. It is showing the entire tracer is going away inside the skeletal muscles, so we cannot target out the target sites. So we are denying the food and or insulin administration before the PET scan. In GI systems, there is a physiological FDG uptake is commonly seen, and we are commonly seeing the colonic uptake, especially after taking the patient who are consuming the metformin. Like this, it is just, it is showing the entire large intestine is showing the FDG uptake, but it's not showing the any pathological thickening or lesion inside the intestine.
How do you get predominantly intestinal uptake?
So actually this uptake is only in most of time depend on the peristaltic movement. If peristaltic movement is more in patients, it's showing the normal uptake. We are the patient who is consuming the metformin for the diabetes, they are also showing the physiological FDG uptake inside the entire large intestine.
So how do we find out that whatever we are seeing like in these images is physiological and not pathological?
So sometimes we are getting the difficulty. Otherwise, pressing the entire body, localized thickening, you are also giving the rectal contrast and acquiring the.
So you use the contrast CT for contrast CT part for differentiation.
Yes.
Okay. You know the SUV max for identification.
No, sir. There is not a contrast. In the urinary tract, it is also excreted by the urinary system. So it is excreted by the kidney and accumulated in the urinary bladder. So at the pelvic pathology is hampered by this accumulated active glucose inside the urinary bladder. So for this type of the patient, we are preparing in the different way. We are giving the Lasix to vacate this urinary bladder, and we are acquiring the MHAC. So after the giving of the furosemide injections, and the entire urinary bladder is empty by the radioactive glucose, and we can actually appreciate the pathological finding in the urinary bladder in addition to the pelvic organ, like in female material in the male, like a prostate cancer also.
So the residual activity, how will we locate when the radioactive material is
if radioactive material, after the giving the furosemide injection, we are trying to empty this urinary bladder. And after the empty of the urinary bladder, if there is any localized thickening inside the urinary bladder, it is prominent.
It will be FDG-avid.
If it is
stay in the lesion, and the urine
is
I think we have to finish.
Yeah.
We have to stop it. And then we will ask
anything. Yes, sir. So, for staging and response assessment, we are commonly using at our site for breast cancers, and for different cancers, we are using at our site. In the gallium-dotonoff PET CT, this is the another PET CT we are using at our site, and this is based on the somatostatin receptor-based imaging, and generally we are using the gallium scan. It is showing the highest affinity for the SSTR2 and high affinity for 3N5. And there are some misconceptions, and I want to reply to all the misconceptions. Can the perform the PET CT in high serum creatinine value? Yes.
There is a cutoff.
There is no cutoff.
And we are introducing the contrast.
No.
PET CT.
PET CT. PET CT in high blood glucose patients, yes. Can we perform the PET CT in children? Yes. After the PET scan, patient can directly shift to the general ward? Yes. We are releasing the patient after taking the readings from the abdominal levels. Is there any pain during the procedure? No. Any serious side effect after the PET scan? No. Any sound during the PET scan? No. After the scan, patient go for sampling? Yes. It's a misconception. Patient cannot go for sampling. Patient go for blood sampling? Yes. Patient go for radiodiagnosis imaging? Yes. Except fluoroscopy. And taking the automatic imaging. So we are denying only fluoroscope imaging.
Fluoroscopy,
I mean, fluoroscope like a X-ray imaging.
Okay.
Inside the body, we have injected the radioactivity. There is some residual activity. So there
is some reaction.
No, they are automatically acquiring the images. They are not causing the artifact, they automatically start to acquire the images. How much radiation dose received in the PET CT is 15 to 25. Microsievert, and how much the radioactivity injected to the patient is depend on the body weight. Are we safe during the scan? Yes. Is patient with injured hand can go for PET scan? Yes. Can general patient go for PET scan? It's a point of debate. And can for screening purpose we have to go or not go for PET scan? It's a point. I mean, like for skin purpose, if I want to go for PET scan, is there any disease inside the body? Is the small size of the lesion can detect by the PET scan? So some person are going for PET scan, like for skin purpose. There is any special instruction for breastfeeding woman? Yes. The breastfeeding woman should stop the breastfeeding at least 24 hours before the scan. Oral contrast is necessary during PET scan? No, we are not using the oral contrast until unless we are not seeing very well visualize the bowel loops. Is IV contrast scan? It's generally it's not required, but we are giving so we can get the good information. Time during the PET CT scan, the entire procedure is taking 2 to 3 hours. The any side effect of the PET scan? No. How much time to stay in the nuclear medicine department? 3 to 5 hours. How much time after the procedure surgeon can go for the surgery? around 4 to 5 hours. If a long surgery, if it takes the more than 3 hours, so should not go on the same MD of the skin. PET scan just after the surgery, yes. Can do the PET scan just before or after the chemotherapy, yes. We can do the PET scan just after or before the radiotherapy, yes. How much half-life of the FDG PET scan inside the body? 30 to 50 minutes, because we are giving the effective half-life. Can we travel in the public bus and train after the PET scan? Yes, you can travel it. Can we go for sexual activity after the PET scan on the same day? Generally, we are denying, but there is no guideline on this thing. So can we take the tea, coffee or alcohol just before the scan? No. Can we smoke before the scan? No. Type of the films provided after the scans depend on the centers. Should issue the CT films for every patient after the scans? Actually, we are requiring the whole body scan. So if we issue the CT films, it is in the thick section. So we can miss the actual information in the CT films. So generally, it should not be issued with the patient. What should we do if we acquire the PET scan for the pregnant higher authority? If we acquire the PET scan of the pregnant lady, and patients should be considered under the gynecologist.
So is it harmful? Like for example, we know that CT guide goes there. There is an amount of radiation that goes into a patient, and anything after a certain number of CTs will be cumulative radiation.
Yes.
Is there something like a cumulative PET dose of 5, 7, 10 PET scans? Ke baad the patient will have features which are suggestive of.
Actually, the dose limits are described by the ARV and other higher societies. They have. For diagnostic of patient beneficial, what we are going for in investigation, they have given that it should not be considered as a permissible dose limits. So, if patient beneficiary, we are doing the these scans, these are not considered in the dose limits.
Thank you very much. Very detailed. I think it's a lot of information and a lot of new information for us.
Which questions have been raised? How many participants?
Yes.
Get an idea of how many students go to that.
11, total were 11, sir. So, concluding, I'm telling you. Okay. After that, was it connected? Sir?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, we are ending the session.